aspiring actuaries. If we haven't met before, my name is Michelle, this is Actuarial, and I currently work as a personalized pricing actuary for a major property and casualty insurer in the province of Ontario, Canada. Today I thought I would address the question of why do actuaries work for insurance companies, and I'm going to take this from two angles. The first angle being, what is the existential reason that actuaries exist at insurance companies, specifically property and casualty insurance companies, because that's my bread and butter, that's what I know best. And the other angle being, what's in it for the actuary? What makes this an interesting job to have at an insurance company? From the insurance company's perspective, if I've said it once on this channel, I'm going to say it 7,000 more times. The big problem with selling insurance is the timing. First, the company sells the insurance policy, then the policyholder may or may not have a claim. The expenses are not known up front when the policy is sold, and this means that there's a lot of uncertainty associated with insurance policies. We don't know if the person is going to have a claim, when they're going to have the claim, and how much that claim is going to cost us. So when you go on Google and you read some generic definition of what an actuary does, quantifying risk, this is the risk that we're trying to quantify. And there are two main roles within a property and casualty insurance company that an actuary would take on. These are the two actuarial fundamental roles that someone would do. That's not to say that actuaries can't work in other parts of the business, but these are the two core functions, the two existential reasons why an insurance company would keep actuaries on their payroll, and that is one, pricing, what I do, and two, reserving. Neither is more important than the other, and they do kind of work in a cycle where reserves will influence prices and prices will influence reserves. In smaller insurance companies, these would be done by the same actuary, whereas at my company, because we are very large, we have separate teams to do separate roles. Going back to the timeline, first sell policy, then maybe have the claim. This means that as an insurance company, we can't just sell the policy, take the money in, and say, this money is all profit, because we don't know how much the expenses are gonna be in the future. What we as actuaries have to do is quantify how much we expect to have to pay in the future so that we can set aside what are called reserves. My next video will actually be teaching a real reserving technique to you guys so that you can see how actuaries will work to try to project claims into the future to try to know how much money we have to set aside for paying claims. Because insurance companies are a financial institution, and because insurance companies are fundamental to the stability of an economy, I truly, honestly do believe that. There's more than just a layer of reserves to make sure that we have enough money to pay out our future claim liabilities. There are lots of layers of provisions for adverse development, capital management oversight, reinsurance, which is insurance bought by the insurance company, just in case their primary insurance gets a little too much, the secondary insurer will then come in and pay some of those claims as well. So there are a lot of layers to make sure that we have enough money to pay out our claim liabilities. But those IBNR reserves are the base, bread and butter foundation of how we know how we're doing financially. An insurance company's financial statement is very dependent on how the actuary set reserve levels. Give 10 actuaries the same data and you're gonna end up with 10 different estimates of where claim liabilities are gonna be. This is one of the frustrating things I would say about being an actuary, where you come from this math university background where there's a right answer and a wrong answer, and then you get into the real world and you're trying to project the future. And there is no right answer. And so what you can bring to the table is not so much the 1 + 1 = 2, therefore I know how to get from 1 + 1 = 2, so I'm an actuary. It's being able to bring context to everything that's going on. It's understanding how the business is changing, how everything is growing together, that really makes you able to understand how reserves should be set. And on the flip side, it's the pricing actuary's job to make sure that we collect enough money from the policyholders to pay out these future claims. A pricing actuary looks at insurance in two ways. On the one hand, we look at the overall macro level of all the insurance policies that we expect to sell, and we say, do we expect to collect enough money in aggregate to support all the claims from this group of people? On the second hand, we say, who is riskier? Who is less risky? Who do we expect to cost us more money? Who do we expect to cost us less money? And then how do we divide up that money? So if we know that in aggregate we need to collect $100 million, we say this person should be charged $1,200 and this person should be charged $800. I haven't been an actuary for very long, but I also haven't seen a lot of movement going on in the how things look in aggregate perspective. It's done using very core fundamental actuarial techniques, looking at rate level indications to try to determine what the future pricing level should be. Where there's a lot of cool fun movement is in price segmentation, in figuring out who to charge $5,000 and who to charge $500. Back in the day, it was probably done by, I don't know, throwing darts at a dart board, and now people moved on to building GLMs, and now people are moving on even further to using machine learning techniques. At my company, and I know at other companies as well, actuaries are working in partnership with data scientists in R and Python, using these machine learning techniques to determine who should be charged what price. I'm absolutely not an expert in machine learning at all, although it is on my to-do list to get more acquainted with it. But from what I understand, the real lift is in a machine's abilities to see interactions between the different variables. There's still a lot of human input into what variables we should be using to determine the prices. There's still a lot of human input into what variables should have monotonic constraints. For example, with a person's age, you don't want them to go from a price of $500 to $1,200 to $200 to $600 to $800. You know, we don't want prices to be going up and down and up and down as someone ages. But as machines get smarter, I don't know what's gonna happen. It's gonna be a very interesting world for sure. So from the insurance company's perspective, that's why we're there, to figure out the right price to charge people and to make sure that we set aside enough money so that we can pay out the claims, and that way we can mush it all together and say, this is how much profit we made. From the actuarial perspective, why do I love working for an insurance company? The first thing that I love is the challenge of what we're trying to do. I am trying to come up with prices for something that is going to happen in the future. The world is constantly evolving. Cars are changing, technologies are changing, the way that people interact with the world is changing. Back at the end of 2018, cannabis became legal in Canada, and there was a big hubbub in my company of how is that going to impact claims? Do we have to raise our prices because we expect more claims because more people are going to be driving under the influence of cannabis, which means that more people will be having car accidents, which means that we have to charge more money. So many things are changing constantly. I've always had a mini dream that I wanted to work for Disney. It's a really magical company, and I wanted a little part of that magic. And so one of my hobbies is every few months I'll go onto the Disney Careers website and just see what kind of jobs they offer. And there was one time a few years ago where Disney posted a job for someone with exactly my experience level, with exactly my skill set. I think the job title was something like a pricing analyst. And from the job description, it seemed like they wanted to price things at the Disney park, so like food and ticket sales and things like that. And there was part of me that said, would I want to apply to this job? Would I want to work at Disney? This is exactly a job description that fits me. And the reason why I didn't apply for this is because even though it was a more magical company, it felt like I would be doing pricing work for a less interesting product. How much variation is there in how much you can charge for a bag of popcorn versus how much variation is there for what you're gonna charge for car insurance, for the ways that you determine why you're gonna make people's prices higher or lower? It's just an interesting challenge to try to keep getting it right, and you're gonna get it wrong every time, and then you're just gonna try to make it ever so slightly more right, and then it's gonna go wrong, and then you're gonna bring it a little bit more right, and then it's gonna be wrong, and then you're gonna bring it a little bit more right, and it's a fun challenge. Another reason why I love working for an insurance company is we have a saying on my team that is, there is no such thing as an actuarial emergency. We are not dealing in life and death. We are not dealing with war. We are not solving world hunger. We are dealing with money. And if we get things wrong, we can cost the company millions of dollars. We can get things very wrong. I mean, there are checks and balances to make sure that we don't get things very, very wrong. Whether I get an analysis done today, or I get it done in 2 days, it's not the end of the world. It is not an emergency. No one is going to die. And because of that, I get to work very regular hours. I get to go to yoga after work every day. I get to take an hour lunch break every day. I'm not gonna say that I never stress out about work, but honestly, for the amount of money that I make and the amount of time that I spend there, I'm not complaining. And I work with the most awesome people, so even when I'm really cranky and don't feel like doing work, I'm just happy that I'm around my coworkers because I love them and they make me happy. Don't forget to subscribe if you want to see my next video, which is going to be a real reserving technique that actuaries use to calculate reserves. Thumbs it up because I'm back on YouTube after a long time and I'm a little bit self-conscious about it. And thank you for calling. Bye!